If you're wiring up your first power supply, you might be a bit intimidated by, well, all of this. And I get it, installing the PSU was one of the most confusing aspects of my first PC build as well. There are connectors that look virtually the same, there are some that are split in two. So in this video, we'll quickly and precisely run through what each cable does and where each should be connected. Stay with me.
Activating Windows is as simple as hopping on over to SCDKey's VIP site where you can purchase an OEM Pro key for a little over 10 US dollars. Use a secure payment method like PayPal, receive your key in a matter of seconds, and activate your OS here to remove that annoying watermark. Click the link below to get started and use my offer code GSL for a sweet discount.
So I understand this video will come across as a bit elementary, a bit basic for those who have built PCs before, but I've been putting more of these videos together lately because of the PC gaming industry is growing at a very rapid rate, especially now. And when given the choice, one should almost always DIY, save money and perhaps learn a thing or two. And that's where these videos come in handy, especially for those beginners. Now, the power supply we'll be using for this demonstration today is a relatively cheap one. It's an EVGA 550 watt. It's called a 550N1, pretty basic name. It doesn't actually even have an 80 plus efficiency, oddly enough. You have to really dig deep to find the minimum efficiency of this unit, which in the box, actually, it only says it on the box, nowhere else, not on the website, anywhere. It says it's above 75%, so all right. Nonetheless, many have been using power supplies like these without issue, and it's probably one that you'll at least consider in your first $500 or so PC build, unless you're going all out and your first PC build costs like $3,000, okay. Probably don't want this. You'll also notice that this unit has all of its cables hardwired to the brick itself, thus classifying it as a non-modular power supply. In the case of modular units, you'll be able to pick and choose what you'd like connected, which could spare you from a bit of clutter when building your PC. And another thing, you don't need to connect every available cable here, right? If you don't need, you know, four or five Molex connections or Sata connections, you can leave these unplugged. So just a rule of thumb going into this. So you can either shove them into an empty spot of your case or leave them entirely disconnected from your unit if you have a modular supply. This also, by the way, applies to PCIe connectors and any other redundant cable. But let's focus on each cable type, what each does, and where each connects to your system, starting first with the largest connector, more than likely, the 20-pin, or you've probably heard it called the 24-pin. There's an extra 4 pins tacked on here. What does this do? Well, this cable is in charge of delivering power to your motherboard and its peripherals. The extra 4 pins you may see dangling next to the 20-pin head are there to provide additional power to your PCIe slots, which are these things here. This cable is vital in modern conventional computers and needs to be connected. The header will look something like this and is often found on the right side of most ATX motherboards. ITX and smaller boards may have this positioned elsewhere due to space limitations. It may even come with adapters, but both 20 and 24 pins are keyed and clipped so they can only be secured one way. Just align the clip side with the notch on the connector. Next, we have the P4 CPU 4-pin or 8-pin EPS. This connector is specifically in charge of providing power to your CPU or the socket, which will not function without it. And depending on your motherboard specification, it'll either accept a single 4-pin, a single 8-pin, an 8-pin and a 4-pin, or dual 8 pins. This is gonna be a bit of a confusing point here. It's easy to understand why. So most modern boards will accept at least a single 8-pin, right? But some higher end boards have an additional 4-pin tacked beside it or an additional 8 pins. So you could have an 8+4 or an 8+8 for CPU power. However, unless you're into some like heavy duty overclocking, connecting just the 8-pin will suffice. Basically, this cable will supply up to 155 watts, and this cable will supply up to 235. You can actually connect just a 4-pin to an 8-pin connector, by the way, though you should always try to connect the full 8 if your power supply provides it. Most affordable CPUs won't pull any more than around 150 watts on their own, but you wouldn't want to overload this single cable or risk system instability. This EVGA 550N1 splits the 8-pin EPS into 2 4-pin counterparts, which can be connected together in a motherboard CPU 8-pin header. It's also notched and keyed only one way, so mind the orientation. Next up, we have PCIe connectors. See, most decently powerful graphics cards will consume at least 100 watts of power or more under load, and the power sent to the card through the PCIe slot via the 24-pin caps out at around 75 watts. So to account for this delta, power supply vendors added supplemental PCIe power cables that look something like this. Often, you'll see a cluster of 6 pins and a daisy chain of 2 pin off to the side. The pinout is relatively straightforward here as well, with the additional 2 pins merely providing grounds for the array of 12-volt leads. And accounting for this additional headroom makes sense because graphics cards with single 8 pins typically pull more power than those with single 6 pins. In some cases even, you'll find that a single 6 plus 2 pin header is actually daisy chained to another 6 plus 2 pin header, meaning that all supplemental graphics card power is being fed down an often lower gauge of wire to handle the increased power draw. If the power supply is designed efficiently, there's really no downside to this design. So if your graphics card requires 2 supplemental 8 pins to function, you'll want to be sure that your power supply comes equipped with them. If the card only requires a single 6 or 8 pin, you can leave any additional PCIe cables unplugged without issue. Also, try to avoid adapters and splitters if possible, especially with some of those higher end cards out there. And just some friendly advice, 8-pin PCIe power cables look awfully similar to CPU 8-pin EPS cables, so be sure to identify which is which before attempting to shove something where it doesn't belong. CPU 8-pin cables will often have a split in the middle to accommodate for systems that accept only P4, but another way to reference it would be via the shape of each pin. Some are notched and some aren't, and you really shouldn't be able to force these into their opposing headers anyway, but I'd still like to point it out in case you're having difficulty getting things to slide in. Next are Sata or serial ATA power connectors. These are 15-pin cables that are intended to power various storage drives, including modern hard disk and solid state drives outside of M.2. These connectors are also used by various fan hubs, controllers, and RGB strips. They're keyed on one side and thus can only be connected one way. And much like the other cables we've already discussed, again, leaving any number of these unplugged is perfectly fine. And lastly, we have Molex power connectors, these chunky things right here. These are a bit older, more simplified than SATA's, consisting of just like literally 4 pins, 2 grounds, and single 12-volt and 5-volt leads. Molex has taken a backseat in recent days. Thankfully, the connector is far more primitive and a bit more difficult to manage at that. Still though, you'll find a few peripherals relying on Molex for discretionary power, including D5 pumps, which need the lower gauge wire for more reliable power delivery. Some older RGB strips and old fans in some cases may have Molex connectors as well. Non-modular power supplies will often include these just to be safe, because you don't want to need a Molex connector and not actually have one, and most people don't have adapters laying around. But in any case, they can often be omitted in modular units for most PC builds that would reduce clutter. And again, Molex is shaped in such a way that cables will only connect one way, so you don't really need to worry about wiring these backwards and sending 5 volts where 12 volts should be sent. And that should take care of just about every connection associated with a conventional and modern power supply. For more information on determining what wattage power supply you'll need for your build, which is another perfectly viable question a lot of people ask, check out this video here. It's also linked in the video description. You can find reliable power supplies and various wattages, by the way, showcased in this video down below. Thank you all for watching. If you have any additional questions, be sure to leave those in the comment section. Consider liking this one, subscribing, and I'll catch you in the next one. My name is Greg. Thanks for learning with me.